Anywhere in America, this would be considered a major college athletic facility. In fact, the NCAA might say that this is a premier college athletic setting. The NCAA also tells us that only one out of every 10 American high school athlete, boy or girl, will ever find their way to a college setting like this. And that is a hard reality. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner, a program which attempts to address those realities. Join us, won't you, as we discuss issues and topics both informative and provocative.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this, once again this evening, is the Inside Corner. The topic this evening is performance enhancement training specific to individual sports. Perhaps you yourself are a weekend warrior, you know, who is recently taken up long-distance running, perchance, or even golf, for that matter, and you want the extra competitive edge, and maybe you're looking for some way to get a leg up on your foursome, or maybe you want to run in that marathon that's coming up in the end of this month of October, and you want to have a manly, or what we might call a substantial finish that you can brag on at the office. And maybe Athletico is for you, or Velocity Performance Enhancement is for you, or maybe it's not. Maybe it's for your children, for whom you'd like to see them have a competitive edge over the neighbor's kids. Maybe you've got some discretionary money laying around the house that you're willing to spend on personal training for your elite athlete who sits across the dining room table from you. Maybe that's it. Maybe this is just a suburban thing. Or is there substance to it? Does a kid, or an adult for that matter, who seeks out specific performance enhancement training for some athletic involvement they're in, maybe you get more out of it than strength and speed. Maybe you learn a whole new set of self-discipline values. But one thing's for sure, you're going to spend your money on it, and you're going to spend your time on it. So we have with us this evening three experts, really, very accomplished experts, three gentlemen who are career committed to performance training, namely Phil Pheifer, who is the Director of Fitness and Performance for all 28 Athletico facilities in the Chicago area. Phil has a master's degree in kinesiology from the University of Illinois at Chicago. He's a certified performance enhancement specialist from the National Academy of Sports Medicine. He's a certified strength and conditioning specialist. He's the former director of fitness for the East Bank Club in downtown Chicago. Swanky place. High priced for sure. He was featured in Men's Health magazine as one of the nation's busiest trainers. That was in 1998. He has a total of 14 years experience specializing in speed development and sport-specific strength and conditioning. And he has worked with Olympic athletes. He has worked with ball players in Major League Baseball, the NFL, the NHL, and Major League Soccer. And to his right, one Eric Stone, who's currently a sports performance coach at Velocity Sports. And let me give you the address for Velocity Sports, and maybe Eric will. No, here it is. That's Velocity Sports Performance at 7051 South Adams Street in Willowbrook. Eric is a certified strength conditioning specialist, a club coach with USA Weightlifting. He is the Illinois chairman for American Powerlifting, the American Powerlifting Federation.
Correct.
And a national competitor, by the way, in his own stead, a national competitor in powerlifting. And to Eric's left, Tom Pukstys. Do you know the name? You might. Because Tom Pukstys is a two-time Olympic team member in track and field. He participated in the 1992 Olympics and the 1996 Olympics as a javelin thrower. He was ranked in the 1990s as many as five times in the top 10 of all javelin throwers in the world. He is currently the U.S. javelin coordinator and a viable candidate at the present time for being the Olympic level javelin coach. Currently teaching a specialty class in velocity for baseball athletes at Velocity Sports, and therefore his colleague is with him tonight, Eric Stone. Again, that's at 7051 South Adams Street in Willowbrook. So there you have it. Three experts, three guys who have been in the trenches, as they say, and who have committed themselves in the career level to performance enhancement. So, weekend warriors, kids who think they're elite athletes, are you listening? Because we have three people here to tell you how to go about it, when to go about it, and whether or not it's worth it. I think that's the aspect parents want to know. Is it worth it? Okay. Let's make believe that none of us have ever heard of this before. But we know the personal trainers. There's the question. Is there a difference between what personal trainers do and what you're doing, Eric, at Velocity Performance? Is there a difference?
There's definitely a difference between what we do and what most personal fitness trainers do. Personal fitness trainers are mostly working with adults and just trying to get them in shape, losing weight. We're dealing with performance. We're trying to get athletes faster. We're trying to get them stronger, more explosive, more agile. Mm-hmm. So we're working on those sports-specific skills that make them an athlete. Yeah. And we have usually expertise that most personal trainers do not have from, just their personal training certification that they got, maybe without even a bachelor's degree. And I don't want to say anything necessarily bad about personal trainers, but what they do is different from what a sports performance coach or a sports performance
trainer
would
do. You've ever been a personal trainer, Phil?
I started my career as a personal
trainer,
yes.
You started as a personal trainer. It said so in your bio.
Yes. First, thanks for the great introduction.
Yeah, you're quite welcome.
I agree with Eric in certain respects, and I think the way we divide personal training from performance enhancement with our company is personal training is more of a fitness-related goal.
Mm-hmm.
Performance enhancement is really a goal where you're aiming for some sort of improvement in your competitive sport, activity. The weekend warrior can fit into this, but if you're looking for a competitive edge over someone else, we like to look at that as performance enhancement. And I also agree that because personal trainers, their bulk of their clientele is looking for something different, they don't deal with a lot of athletes, and you really have to understand how the body works in a competitive format to be able to train athletes. Mm-hmm. It just makes sense that you're going to work to get them better at what they do, and that necessarily doesn't follow the same protocol that you would with a person looking to just get fit.
Okay, so thus far your comments have been about specific attack related to mechanical aspects of certain sports. In other words, if I'm a pitcher in baseball, can I go to Tom Pukstys, a former javelin champion, for pitching lessons?
Well, I have baseball experience too. I did try out the Yankees.
I know that.
Well, the fact is I enjoy throwing, so from a personal perspective, I've done the research and have been involved in research regarding pitching and throwing mechanics in general. So it's not that I'm coaching javelin throwers. If I did, there's only so few of them.
Yeah.
Nobody would listen.
Just kind of a low incident sport, isn't it? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Not so many people try, but millions of people do throw things in this country, in football and baseball. I mean, who cherishes or what athletes do we cherish more in the world than pitchers and quarterbacks? So,
exactly.
I follow, of course. What's great for me is my background is simply the track and field background gives me the high performance standards of sprinting, jumping, and overall capacity, and then my own personal background in throwing and my knowledge and love for baseball. I did the research and figured it out.
Tell me if this is a true story. I heard a story that you, was this in Florida where you threw 10 baseballs over the center field fence from home plate at some field down in Florida, spring training camp? In the Yankees farm system?
Something like that. It was actually at the University of Florida. I was training my arm velocity by doing long toss. Everybody knows long toss. So I was throwing from center field into home plate.
From center field to home plate.
Yeah, it's not that terribly far. For me at the time,
400 feet?
No, at the time it was about 325 from where I was standing.
Oh, I see.
So there was a batting backstop and over the home plate. And then, well, the catcher from the University of Florida, it was a friend of mine, Jimmy Bell, and we, of course, had a little bit of, you know, competitive spirit.
Oh, heck yeah,
all the time. So I put my left leg down and planted it. Instead of throwing low, I threw high, and I cleared the backstop of the actual stadium.
Oh, my God. So it was a 400-foot throw.
Yeah, I've been measured at 403 officially.
Did you do that more than once?
The 403 was at my maximum. I mean, normally it's like 375. Oh my God, that's so hard to throw that far.
I've never seen anyone throw a ball 400 feet.
People can throw farther, but at least I got the 403.
That's mysterious. That's mysterious. 400-foot baseball throw is remarkable.
Yeah, there's been people that can do better.
Describe one aspect of what you're doing with kids.
My favorite?
That they can't do for themselves.
Oh, our experience, absolutely. Our experience gives them the, you can follow roads to success, and we can take you into the roads that we guarantee that success that other athletes of high caliber have taken. We have that experience and knowledge. But if you're just a 14-year-old boy sitting at home wondering, what do I got to do to be on TV playing baseball or football or basketball? We know these aspects that you have to do. We'll teach you how to not take that dumb road or the poor one that won't lead to that success. We just know that.
So if I went over to Athletico for two sessions and I got the regimen down, do I have to go back for a third one?
You sure would. The one thing we do as a sports medicine-based company, we make sure that we're training a complete athlete. So whatever athlete we see, they're going to go through what we call a performance profile. And we're going to look at them and test them, give them an assessment to find out where their weaknesses, their deficiencies are, whether it's muscle imbalances, previous injuries that may be harming their athletic ability at the time. And we won't touch an athlete until we know that. So they do go through the screening process. Then we work from the ground up, correcting the imbalances, correcting the deficiencies to build them into a complete athlete, and then get more involved into speed development, the strength training, the power explosive training.
I mean, Phil's experience, outrageous, tremendous experience. So what does he do? He knows what the bona fide world-class athletes or professional athletes that he has seen have skills, characteristics, abilities, flaws. So he knows how to shape a young athlete into that ideal.
Okay. I think that the key with young athletes is that it cannot be a three-day speed camp. You need to get into the athlete, and it needs to be years set aside programming. You can't do it in a weekend. You can't do it in a three-month period. No. If you want to build a complete athlete and have this athlete reach their potential, then you need to design programming where they're with you for 4, 5, 6, 7 years till they hit the high school level. It's just the way that you build from ground up into their final stages.
Okay, so if it's a developmental program you're offering.
But there's
he can't cut out after the second week and say, well, I know the drill now. I don't have to go back there and do this by myself. Right, so it's a developmental step program. Am I correct?
If they want to get better, they need to dedicate themselves to that.
Okay, then let me ask you this. Have you ever had a client, when you got to step 5, you knew that the potential in this kid was tapped out? That's it. You knew at step 5, or 4, or 3 for that matter, as good as you are, experienced as you are, maybe early on, you knew, I'm only going to get so far with this kid. Have you ever had that feeling?
No, I'd argue that point. I would never say that the potential is tapped out. They may not be on their way to the NFL or the major league ranks, but there's always the potential for them to be a better athlete than what they are, and that's what we as experts bring to the table. There's just certain ways that we can develop people to get better, whether it's speed, whether it's agility, whether it's strength, whether it's explosive. It may not be at that elite level by the time we're finished, but they will see increases week to week, month to month, year to year, as they buy into these programs.
Eric, what's the youngest kid you've ever worked with?
Youngest kid, we have a 7-year-old in our program that we've worked with.
A 7-year-old?
And, you know, with that age kid, we're basically just trying to work on their basic fitness, get their mechanics fixed, work on body weight, strength. You know, when you think about it, running is a body weight exercise.
You're just a male.
You're moving your body weight. So in strength training with the youth athletes, we work on relative strength especially. That's the ability to move your body weight. I mean, if a kid can't do a push-up, what's the point in having them do, you know, a bench press?
Yeah.
If they can't squat their body weight,
Right.
Would you ever put weight on them? No. So
7 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And does that strike you as being
no? I've had an 8 year old. Why? Yeah, gymnasts and tumbling are doing it at
gymnasts,
age 4 and 5.
Yeah,
I mean, athletes are starting at 5 and 6, and putting forces on their body with basketball, football, you know, soccer, that are far greater than the forces they would ever have in moderate strength training.
Yeah.
You know, in moderate supervised strength training, speed development, and movement training, the forces on the body are far less than in a football game or a basketball game. And it behooves parents to train their kids to prepare them for the movement that they're going to be doing in their sports.
I also think that kids are participating a lot earlier than we do when we're their age.
Yeah.
You know, I just coached a 5 and 6 year old.
That's
team.
The sociology I want to talk about. Why are they starting sooner? And we're gonna approach that. You parents better be listening, because the next question, the next segment, I want you to stick around for, are parents pushing the wrong kids? My name is Terry Sullivan. This is the Inside Corner. We're going to take about a 2-minute break, but we're going to be right here waiting for you. Please come back. You're watching Channel 99 or 16, depending on where you live, but we'll be right here. Come back, please, after this public service announcement.
Neurofibromatosis,
or NF, is a genetic disorder that causes tumors to grow anywhere on or in the body. It can lead to blindness, deafness, loss of limbs, brain tumors, and severe disfigurement.
Neurofibromatosis.
Let me make it easy for you. Children's Tumor Foundation. The Children's Tumor Foundation, dedicated to ending neurofibromatosis through research. Let's all start saying it.
Children's Tumor Foundation.
1,200 American youth run away from their homes every day. The National Runaway Switchboard is here to help. 1-800-RUNAWAY. If you are a runaway, thinking about running away from home, or a parent or guardian concerned about issues facing your child, call us 24 hours a day. 1-800-RUNAWAY. In times of crisis, hope is just a phone call away. 1-800-RUNAWAY.
How far would you go to help someone? Would you go to the end of your driveway? Would you cross a street? Would you cross an ocean? Would you go if you could use your knowledge to teach someone? And in the process, maybe learn something yourself. Life is calling. How far will you go? Peace Corps.
Sure, my neighbors Gene and Louise, they may be superheroes with superpowers, but that doesn't make them so super at saving energy and money.
Honey!
I may not be able to harness the power of the elements, but I save significant cash and help the environment with appliances, electronics, and windows featuring the Energy Star label. So discover your own energy-saving superpowers. Go to ase.org/consumers.
Mom, Dad's making fondue again.
Hello, everyone. Again, my name is Terry Sullivan. Welcome back to the Inside Corner. You're watching either Channel 16 or 99, depending on where you live in the area. We are discussing sport-specific performance enhancement training. We have three experts with us, career-committed professionals in the sports performance training business, namely Phil Pheifer, Director of Fitness for 28 Athletico Facilities in the Chicago area, Eric Stone of Velocity Performance in Willowbrook, and Tom Pukstys, former Olympian, and presently teaching pitching classes, actually, former javelin thrower, now pitching velocity training, teaching velocity training and pitching at performance enhancement, velocity sports performance. There's such a repetitiveness of the words performance and sports, and I'm mixing it up, okay? But I do know the difference. Okay. Are you encountering parents who are pushing the wrong kids into your enhancement programs? Or, if that question doesn't bring to mind any examples, are you finding parents who are wrongly pushing kids.
What I see a lot is parents who push kids into specialization of sports too early. Mm-hmm. They'll, you know, at a very young age just decide, I'm only going to play this sport and I'm going to play it year-round. Instead of having a well-rounded, you know, diet as a kid of different sports, different activities, you know, even some sports performance training alongside of it. But, you know, we see a lot of repetitive stress injuries. I'm sure that Phil sees that as well with volleyball players and baseball players and other athletes who spend so much time in one movement pattern or, you know, one particular movement so young. I've seen a girl 13 years old who already has a stress fracture in her shoulder from playing volleyball basically 10 months out of the year.
True. And how could she possibly have enjoyed it?
Yeah.
In Minnesota, there's a cabinet level office in the governor's office, Minnesota Association of Amateur Sports. There's actually an advisor in the cabinet level who tells the government what's going on in various nationally franchised amateur sports in Minnesota, Little League, ASY Soccer, AAU, Pop Warner Football, you name it, and they report to the governor's office. And their statistics, and you can look online if you wish, their statistics say that 70% of the kids in the state of Minnesota quit their organized sport by the age of 13. 70% of them. And given this necessity being pushed by parents that they must do it 10 and 12 months a year, I can't help but think the burnout effect isn't right there.
There is a big burnout effect. I see it with volleyball athletes. My club that I work out of is primarily volleyball, and unfortunately I have girls that are stars and are quitting their sport at age 17 and 18. Mm-hmm. And it's unfortunate, but not everybody quits. Some people move on. It just depends on how much, the sport of volleyball itself is one of those 11 month a year sports, and maybe it's too much.
Every coach is telling you that, though. Every coach is saying, our sport, you got to play it all the time.
Yeah, well,
basketball in particular.
So our role is to improve sports performance.
Yeah.
But I also have to play the role of psychologist.
Yeah, you do.
And I have, at many times in my last 5 years, have been more of a home of counseling, composure. Yeah. I want to be the place that this young athlete can go and sort of save himself from the pressures of his parents or other peers.
So you are meeting parents who are pushing kids wrongly.
Absolutely.
Now, what about you, Phil?
Well, I would look at it. I just coached a 5- and 6-year-old Little League team, and that was 3 years before we started playing.
Did you say what?
5- and 6-year-old Little League team.
5- and 6-year-old Little League?
And these kids could play.
T-ball?
So I'm not against. No, it's coaches pitch. Yes,
coaches
live pitching.
Pitch.
And I'm not so much against them playing, but I think it's more of what Eric hit on. It's the specialization. It's what Tom hit on with the traveling teams. Yep. I think they've gotten in and they've created a problem that it's going to be hard to reverse. And that problem being is, how do you not allow your kid to do it if the feeling is he's going to get left behind because everybody else is doing it? And I think we've gotten ourselves into a bad spot. Now, Tom mentioned, and I'm sure Eric sees this too, is the problem is you play. Let's look at traveling baseball. I played in the Chicago Catholic League. We can only play, 33 games a season.
35, yeah.
Yet traveling baseball teams are playing 96.
Yeah, right.
And we are elite high school athletes.
Yeah.
These are 11, 12, 13-year-old kids.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where is the time for the fundamentals? You don't learn how to hit a curveball by facing the best curveball pitchers
every day.
Three times a week.
Yeah.
You don't learn how to catch, you know, take ground balls at third base once or twice in a game when they come to you. And I think we're losing out on fundamentals. And to bring it back into our realm of what we do as a career, you cannot train the volleyball player when they don't have an off season. Yet the parents will throw them into our clinics or into our facilities and ask them to train.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when they're practicing 5 days a week and there's no layoff and then they want to see us 3 days a week, it becomes tough for us to be that resource to get the kids to the next level.
Yeah.
Their bodies don't have the time to kind of regroup and settle down and then be able to work at a high intensity level.
You're hoping to be the refuge
for
the kid,
but
for some kids.
Let me explain it like this. If you want to be a really a wicked athlete in the area, we know how to do it. I know how to do it. I've been there, done that,
yeah.
Got the t-shirt, and yeah. I worked hard. I understand how to take training to the limits of your desires, your passions, till you think you're going to die. I know these things. I know where it's going to lead to. I know how much you can take. I know what the body can handle, when to take a break, when not to. But I also have to know how to help a young man who will never be very good
or
at sport,
woman.
Or a young woman, how to enjoy it. Because at the end of the day, I know world-class athletes who have medals and millions of dollars, and they're upset about something. They're mad. They're angry about their lives. I don't get it. I don't have richness or notoriety or fame and fortune, but I had a blast as an athlete. Yeah. Was it hard? I think about, man, I spent so much time in pain and misery, but why did I have so much fun? So I want to make sure that my athletes, if they're going to be good, they're going to be great. But if they're not going to be good, they're going to have a darn good time doing it. I'm going to make it happen.
Well, then your training, even though people watching are getting the impression that you guys are hardcore conditioners, really, you're addressing the intangibles also.
Yeah, you think that we're going to be
the
in your face?
Emotional control, no. The focus, the perspective.
We're sensitive.
Need to have. Yeah.
I mean, you want them to enjoy movement. Yeah. You want them to enjoy training so that if they're done with sports in 2 years, which is, as you said, very possible, at least maybe they'll keep their body in shape, you know, going to the local gym. And
Could be a lifelong pursuit.
Staying healthy.
Like Phil, I'm sure, will teach perfect squat technique, you know, how to take care of your shoulder. So for that weekend warrior who is 30 years old and says, you know, that guy, that one coach I had when I was 13, he showed me how to do the shoulder work, and he'll do it. And he'll be 32, and the stuff he learned at 13, he'll remember, and that'll work. Because it's going to work. It's work.
Okay, which of the athletic skills that your programs address, which of those skills do you think you make the least headway with? The least. In other words, they're probably God-given abilities, and you're only going to be able to coach or train toward the improvement of that ability to a certain extent, and then you get diminishing returns. Which skill is it?
Fast twitch muscle fiber, explosiveness, meaning like the ability to jump high. I can't take a person who is vertically jumping 19 inches and probably by their most talented moment in their lives will be 24 or 5 inches, and I can't take them to 30. Mm-hmm. And if anybody's marketing that, they're lying
they're
through
lying.
Their teeth.
Yeah.
So because my business is more personalized, I don't sell any kind of guarantees of incredible, you know, improvements. But there are going to be, for almost everybody, improvements. As long as you're working hard, you're going to improve. But so probably the explosive factor. But motor skill-wise, you can learn for a long time. I mean, you can become a good bowler at age 80 if you start even at age 70.
You guys don't do anything with vision training?
No, we don't do that.
No,
it's out of your domain.
Not my skill level.
Do you believe in it? Do you believe in it for baseball or tennis?
Well, I know lots of pros that have done without it.
I think it's something that you can develop.
Golfers don't need it, do they?
I think that would be something you can develop, you know, on the field, on the court. You know, that from playing repetition
time after time.
There's
a lot of controversy about vision training.
I have.
Yeah, I've seen some.
Yeah. The ophthalmologists that I've talked to say it's hogwash. That you cannot improve the tracking ability of the human eye. You can't.
I've heard about it, but I'm not. I don't support it.
It's a neurological hookup, and that's the way it is. Yours is what it is, and mine is what it is, and you're not going to get any improvement out of it. That's what ophthalmologists I've talked to have said. So there are some skills. Guy comes into Athletico, and he wants to improve such and such a skill, and that might be the one you think you get diminishing returns on. It happens. Huh?
It happens, and I would say, in answering your last question, I would say that's individualized with each athlete you see.
Yeah.
Some that may be speed development. Some it may be explosive strength. Some it may be some sort of resistance training. But I think it is based on each athlete that comes in the door. So it differs. And that's why we do individualized programming, because you can't treat each athlete the same way. Cookie-cutter programs don't cut it at the levels that we teach performance to our athletes.
Okay, which came first? It's a chicken or the egg question. Which came first? The athletes who are seeking out specific performance enhancement, or the performance enhancement industry came first and impressed upon people that they need to have it?
I would say it was the athlete.
The athlete,
I agree with Tom.
First.
The athlete has always been looking for ways, any way they can, to improve, be it, you know, illicit drugs or some type of extra training outside of their sports training. You know, they've been looking for any way that they can to improve. Mm-hmm. And I think the industry built itself around that need. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't think the industry could have ever been built without that need already being there.
Definitely the need was there first. And just people, coaches saw that, hey, you, obviously there's an income available in it. So I'm almost sure it would be definitely the athletes seeking it out. And then knowledgeable coaches saying, hey, I can teach this, but I could actually earn a living. And it's a wonderful living. If you think that coaching athletes isn't the best thing in the world,
of course.
We're not here because we're angry bad guys. I mean, I love my job. It's unbelievable.
There's a real satisfaction, even though it might be vicarious. It's a real satisfaction. The other criticism that comes up about specific performance training and the companies that propose that they can bring a kid to the elite level. The other criticism that I have heard and read is that your companies would never exist if we had a culture of motivated athletes.
That's totally not true.
The implication being that the motivated athlete will be out there on his own doing his own thing, and wouldn't need.
But they're still inexperienced.
Yeah, they're not going to have the experience and the know-how of how to train. Yeah.
You look, bring your taxes to your accountant. You know,
I do.
You have a toothache, you go to a dentist. Yeah. The same thing. We can learn, we can educate ourselves, but we are experts that can take what you have and show you how to bring it to another level. It's that simple. It's one of the things that we try to impress upon so much with the high school coaches. Yeah. High school coaches, probably, I don't know if you guys would agree, I think the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade athlete is a lot easier to get into our facilities. The high school coaches like to have control over their athletes and their weight rooms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I think one of the challenges is you have some great high school coaches. They're not experts in strength training, speed development, and that's where
but some schools do have strength coaches.
And some have very good. I'm not trying to paint a broad brush, but what I'm saying is the schools, and we have over 30 high school contracts at Athletico, the schools that utilize us as a resource, and that can be a coach saying, I don't have a solid ACL prevention program. I don't have a solid overhead athlete throwing program. I could use some help with speed development. Whatever they need us as a resource, we're there to help them with. We don't come in and dictate their programs, but we're there with limited budgets and limited manpower and limited, let's say, expertise in these areas to come in and help them in any way they see fit. And that's kind of where we're trying to go with our high school groups, is that most coaches are teaching a full day of school. Mm-hmm. Most coaches have to worry about the X's and O's. Yeah. Hand your training and your speed development and that over to experts like us, and we'll be the expert to come in and help your club.
Okay, then, Phil, you're absolutely right about that, and I know we haven't been a teacher and a coach. There's only so many hours in a day, and you'd like to treat that whole athlete, and you never get around to doing it. However, I can't turn to every kid on the squad and say, this is the alternative other than me. Mm-hmm. This is where you can go, because I don't know if that kid has the financial wherewithal to walk in an Athletico or Velocity Sports Performance. Who, you know what I mean? So my point is, are you training the affluent athlete? Are you getting the rich kid?
Well, in some cases, I definitely get people who can afford it and want me to babysit their kid because they want their kid to train with the Olympic guy. But I don't come from this level, so I also want to be available for people who don't have the money. So I do my best to offer, whether it's smaller levels of commitment to my programming or try to have some free clinics. We do have free clinics, and definitely Velocity has free clinics. I'm sure Phil will probably adopt the same idea, and to have some, to be able to be helpful to society.
Yeah.
And as a whole, it's in our nature to help. We want to help. We want to make money, but we want to help.
Of course.
Yeah. And
well, you need to exhibit improvement in the kid if you're going to make any.
Absolutely. So
you're going to be invested.
If you do the training in larger groups, like for teams, you can make it inexpensive enough where the affordability factor is a lot higher.
We do a lot of outreach programming. Our company is based on community. If you look at where we're located, we're tied into the area high schools or grade schools. Yeah. And we'll go and we'll work with grade schools for different functions, whether it's training, whether it's showing kids how to stretch for the walkathon, things like that that we'll go out and do. We do a lot of ground-based training with our high school contracts at a very minimal fee. And some of our contracts aren't affluent high schools in the area. But, you know, we try to get the message out to anyone who wants to work with us.
But again, it's competition, and the world is all about competition. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. If you want to have a little bit, you have to pay the price.
Yeah, I guess you do.
And sometimes that price is money.
You have to sacrifice somewhere along the line. We have to sacrifice time right now because we're going to take a public service announcement break, but we'll be right back on the Inside Corner, channel 16 or 99. Stay with us.
I just wanted to eat like a normal human being, you know? Just something I could hold down without the horrible pain.
Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis are diseases that attack the digestive system.
A feeding tube's not my idea of a good meal.
At the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation of America, we're excited about the latest research.
Then there was this new drug.
Thousands of people are being treated with new drug therapies.
Doc said it doesn't work for everyone, but I got lucky.
CCFA provides a lifeline of research, education, and support.
Now I'm taking food the old-fashioned way. I'm eating it.
Hi, Mr. President. My parents believe that eating meals together will make our country strong. Is this something that you did when you were a kid?
I did eat with my family so long as my mother wasn't cooking.
It's not good making fun of your mother, even if you are president, but it is good to have dinner with your kids. We know the more often children have dinner with their families, the less likely they are to smoke, drink, and use drugs. So simply having dinner together can help your children forever. Even if you're not a great cook.
An important message for people with diabetes. Diabetic neuropathy is a serious complication of diabetes. One in two people with diabetes has it. Damaged nerves can cause stinging, burning, tingling, numbness, or weakness in your feet and hands. You can be very sensitive to touch, and everyday activities can cause extreme pain. But it's not too late. Contact the American Diabetes Association at 1-800-DIABETES or diabetes.org, or talk to your doctor.
Thanks for coming back, everyone. Again, my name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner, and we talk sports information here. And we have a good topic this evening, one relevant for you, particularly parents who are thinking about giving their kids a leg up on the a competitive edge. And have you been considering performance enhancement training specific to your son or daughter's sport? Well, then this is the discussion to listen into in the next 15 minutes, because I have three experts with me, namely Phil Pheifer, who's the Director of Fitness and Conditioning for 28 Athletico facilities in the Chicago area, and one Eric Stone from Velocity Sports Performance in Willowbrook, and Tom Pukstys, two-time Olympic javelin thrower, 1992 and 96, fifth rank in the world for in a 10-year period between 1990 and 99. These are gentlemen who know what they're talking about in terms of specific approaches to the improvement of strength and speed and conditioning in sports. I want to ask a question, though. Is this whole urge to be a better athlete, is this whole urge to get personal attention, to get the competitive edge, is it peculiar just to the United States? Now, Tom, you have ties, strong Lithuanian ties. Your parents are
Lithuanian.
Or Lithuanian.
My brother went to medical school in the Soviet Union in Lithuania for 6 years.
All right. I want to know. Is this going on over there?
Yeah, absolutely. It's all about pride. But sports is a little different. I think, in my experience, 20 years international experience, sports in this country, a lot more greed, and in Europe and the rest of the world, a little more spirit and pride for achievement and respectability for their country, for their nationalities, for their background. Here, because the almighty dollar, it's all about like
money.
A lot of it. Not everybody.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. In Lithuania today, and you've already told me the capital city, please.
Vilnius.
In Vilnius today, is there anything like Velocity Sports Performance Center? Is there a center? Anything like that?
No, because there's professional coaches.
Would Lithuanians go to pay their euros?
The government, and also there's professional coaches already, so those kids would go into clubs or club basketball.
There are.
Yeah, and it, the European training systems are based on their government spending. So no, in this country, we're the private sector. If the government, the federal government, paid for training, it would be just like, basically it would pay guys like us to do the same thing we're doing. Mm-hmm. We would get paid through taxes, where in Finland, I spend a ton of time in Finland, we know that there's great athletes in Finland. They got the best Grand Prix racers in the world. They got great hockey players. Great skiers, big time sports. Nobody would pay to get coached there because you go into a school that already has professional coaches on staff teaching and coaching kids from the time that they're 5 and 6 years old to the time they become NHL hockey players, professional or gold medal, you know, skiers or rally racers or Grand Prix Formula One racers.
The only difference is that in America is that there is an entrepreneurial or profit motive factor built into the system, and that can be good. It can be injurious, too. If I had a daughter who was a competitive cheerleader, should I be bringing her to you?
You sure should.
Yeah?
You sure should. There's going to be a number of different times where she's going to have some injuries that need to be looked at, some deficiencies in her skill that are going to need to be addressed. Mm-hmm. Competitive cheerleading now has become a big sport.
By the way, if you didn't know everyone at home, competitive cheerleading is an IHSA sanctioned sport in Illinois now. Not every high school in the state is involved, but it is a sanctioned IHSA sport, and it may get even bigger than what it is now. So if my daughter's a competitive cheerleader, you can help her.
Sure can. There's tons of skill set in a competitive cheerleader, going from explosive power to, most importantly, I would say, core strength. And there's some phenomenal athletes that do some things with their bodies that we didn't see 15 years ago when we talked about the sport of cheerleading. They should train just like every other athlete trains.
Do you think... No, this is nuts.
Hey, the toughest guy I knew at the University of Florida was a cheerleader, by the way.
Really?
Yeah, his name was Rhett Lewis, the last guy I'd want to fight. I'm not kidding you. He was the toughest guy, a cheerleader.
This guy was so strong, he can lift
anybody up and hold them for 15 minutes and have lunch and no problem.
Yeah.
Phenomenal athlete.
I'm not impugning that. I'm just saying that I'm trying to say there might be a universal fit. You know, as long as there's bodily movement, strength and endurance involved, and speed involved, and companies like these can help.
We've worked with athletes everywhere from baseball and basketball to
bowlers,
cheerleaders,
bowlers.
No bowlers, but Irish dancers was probably the most.
Yeah, that was my next question. What about dancers? Mm-hmm. You've helped them.
Mm-hmm. Competitive ballroom dancers.
Really?
We have a gentleman now that we train at our Garfield Ridge facility. He's a competitive ballroom.
Oh my God. Yeah. What do you do? What do you do with them? Describe a drill.
We do a lot of balance work, a lot of lower body explosive again.
Is he a younger fella?
He's probably mid-30s. We do a lot of core strengthening for them to hold their posture during their dance moves. And again, a lot of footwork, a lot of agility work, a lot of upper body strength to be able to hold their poses while they're dancing.
He comes just
dancing.
By himself, not with a partner.
Comes just by himself.
Yes. Isn't that amazing?
See, I think this goes back to a question you asked earlier about training athletes. My background is football and baseball. I play college football and baseball. Mm-hmm. But I can train any athlete. I train ice skaters. And we can train them because the cream of the crop understands how the body works. We don't need to understand exactly the sport. We need to know how the body is asked to perform while it's performing that sport.
The kinesiology. Mm-hmm. Right? That's what you're addressing. That's your expertise.
Yes. We know progression. We know how much time a certain athlete can take a certain level of load. We know load limits. We know physiology, anatomy.
In the toss of the javelin, there are those balletic steps you take.
The run-up, yeah.
Yeah, the run-up that you take sideways before you get to do the actual release. Seems to me like there's a dance element in that.
Well, it's
right?
It's something that I work with an athlete that I train every day.
See?
I'm training a javelin thrower, and I have to teach him how to run sideways. It's a specific skill that is required for you to set up to be able to make a better release. It requires you to run a certain way to use your hips.
Do they crossover step?
Yeah, it's a crossover front over back. It's like a crow hop in baseball.
It's balletic.
There's
ballet in it.
It looks it because they make it look easy. The best athletes in the world that do it, the best javelin throwers, well, they're great athletes, absolutely.
We did a show, Dancers as Athletes, and we had a choreographer from Harris Street Dance and three professional dancers from Harris Street. Now, these are some of the best in America, in the world perhaps. And when they described their regimens, their training regimens, it was far and beyond what, for instance, the high school kid could cope with. Far and beyond the disciplines were, oh man, they were strict.
There's a capacity by each age group, and one good thing about, I'm sure Velocity, I know Velocity's programming because I know the founder of Velocity, and actually when I was at my prime, I asked him for help. So really? It's kind of ironic that I'm sort of working under, with him. It's great. I mean, I've known the man for 17 years. So generally, athletes who get older, they have, when your maturity is at its peak, you can sustain a little more mental attention to what you're doing. So the physical body, we can handle a lot. You know, you hear about people surviving days out in the woods in the desert, so we can handle a ton more. It's just our minds that pretty much hold us back. You don't want to get into a dangerous level, then you have to know physiology. Of course, I don't want to injure somebody, but a highly tuned, mature 20-something athlete, they can take a maniacal level load to the body. If they can maintain their attention and desire to compete, you wouldn't believe what they can do. You wouldn't believe what they can do.
Yeah, you never underestimate the depth of resource of a human being.
And a high school athlete's not quite capable of those.
Not quite. The focus and maturity and
you teach them how to get to that point.
We're going to catch a whole lot of viewers with this question because golf is a religion. I don't know if you know this. It's I'm an agnostic when it comes to golf. It's just another source of misery. I can't understand why people even play it. And it's expensive. Could you help a golfer?
Actually, we have a golf fitness program where we work with a number of golfers. And we work on rotational hip strength, hip mobility, balance.
Weighted clubs?
No. We use medicine balls,
weighted. To the strength of the core.
Mm-hmm. So we use weighted implements, definitely. Mm-hmm. We don't necessarily use weighted clubs. You don't want to, mess up with their swing of the club.
The mechanics, yeah.
Yeah, you don't want to mess up the mechanics. Just as a baseball player wouldn't go out and use a real heavy bat when he goes up to bat.
Right.
But we certainly work on the rotational strength and mobility, their balance,
shoulder
stability. So this
is an actual class. Mm-hmm. How many might be in the class at a given time?
We have, all of our classes are usually up to six athletes.
The athletico guy is writing this down. He's going to steal this right here.
No, we work with athletes, from adults to golf athletes to high school.
Do you have 20 people in that class?
No, we would never have classes above six. We work in small groups.
Oh, really?
So it's a small group type of setting, unless we're doing a team training where we're working with, a baseball team or a basketball team specifically in that large setting, but...
Golfers will spend money.
A lot of money on their club memberships. If you've ever talked with them, how much they pay, it's probably more than a lot of our salaries for an entire year.
Yeah, we have a golf performance center in Oak Brook, and we do it a little differently. And where we
what's the location?
It's just next to the Oak Brook Shopping Center.
Really?
On Kingery, Route 83.
On 83.
Mm-hmm. And 16th Street. It's in the Oaks.
And what's it called?
It's an athletico physiotherapy center with our golf performance center
inside.
And the difference is we use 3D swing analysis where we'll take a golf pro and hook you up to what is called a K-vest. And we will watch your swing through the video analysis with a golf professional. And then the second part of that 3D swing analysis is you're working with the physical therapist on the actual golf fitness part of it. So we get to see where your deficiencies are in your swing. Then you work with a physical therapist, trained professional that looks at that swing and designs programs around it.
This is very specific. You have the religion? Do you have the religion?
I'm a golf fanatic. Yeah, of course. Yeah. I love the game. It's very challenging, mentally and emotionally and physically. But I'm going to do a similar thing for the pitchers. I don't have the equipment to do the analysis on site at Velocity, but my knowledge and information and my judgment and will be based on that kind of research analysis on pressure plates and joint angular velocities and how you react to these things. And so something like that, but not just I don't have the money to spend on on the machines.
You will. Once your expertise is acknowledged, you will. Okay, serious question, and parents want to know. because there are lots of rumors. You run into kids you suspect of using performance-enhancing drugs. Are you running into kids you suspect?
Yes.
Yes.
I have not run into any when I've been working at Velocity or as a sports performance coach, but in my experience in powerlifting and my own experience as an athlete, I've definitely worked out with and have experience with those that use performance-enhancing drugs. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's probably far more widespread than most people would like to admit to, I would just say.
What do you think, Phil?
No, I don't have any personal experiences, and I wouldn't go out and try to guess who does and who doesn't.
Yeah.
I'm a firm believer, though, that I only preach to my expertise. So when it comes to supplementation, when it comes to nutrition, I refer them to a nutritionist. I won't touch that subject.
Yeah, same as me. Yeah. I keep my I know my limits.
All right, then tell parents out there listening, where are the kids getting it if they are using it? Do you have that knowledge, that kind of knowledge? Where
if
would
I
they
can
go?
Catch the guy who's giving that disinformation, I would be I would be rabid dog to stop that person or people. They just don't, that's who the enemy is of a guy like me or Eric or or Phil, is we're trying to teach how to do it without those things and how to be spirited and passionate. And
but they're available to kids.
It's usually
not anywhere. Not that easy.
What's the stereotypical place where a kid picks it up?
You know, it's usually like a chain of command. You have someone when they were young who were looking for steroids, found someone in the gym who uses them, and then became a dealer. The person who used them later in life, would they become a dealer as well? So it's usually someone
who uses steroids? Those who are weak mentally, who can't take reality, so they go to
something
that's...
Is it expensive?
I'm sure it is. I don't know. I know the elite stuff that were like people that I know in track, but that's really expensive.
And you think it is prevalent at the Olympic level?
Yeah, but not everybody. Don't think that every champion you see on TV or every baseball player or football player is on it. That's ridiculous. There are people who are genuinely just great at what they do.
Yeah, I would admit that.
Don't think that.
I think there's lack of education that needs to be addressed across the board, because it doesn't need to be anabolic steroids. It can be the misuse of creatine.
Absolutely.
Every kid sees it. The problem we have now as professionals is that we're dealing with a more educated clientele than we did 10 years ago. They can get it from the internet, they can get it from TV, they can get it from magazines. And they're going to read and they're going to catch on to whatever they think is the most popular, the most easiest way to get to a certain point. Mm-hmm. A lot of kids are doing creatine. Creatine could be good if you're doing it the right way, but there's no one there to teach the kids what the right way is.
Yeah, and it seems like people go overboard on limitations. Would have the experience to... Like, if you don't want to do plyometric jumping from too high of a box, if you go too high, you can compress the spine, hurt your back, you can make damage, hurt your knees. If you go to a certain, there's a certain limit, and some people think the more the better, and we know those limits. We're certified experts. Yeah. Phil's got the major experience. Eric's certified to know these things. We've gone through school for it. We understand. Yeah. And we're able to then teach those kids, here's how you do it without those things.
Well, I think Phil's analogy was the best tonight, which was if I have a tax problem, I go to an accountant.
Yeah.
You know, that's a good analogy. If my tooth is hurting, I'd go to a dentist. I go to somebody who's had the experience and has been in the arena, and dentists who have toothaches of their own, those are the ones I like. Well, look. Everyone's looking to get a leg up in pursuit of the scholarship, in the pursuit of some sort of elite status. If you're going to put your kids in the hands of somebody who might help them get closer to the scholarship level or elite class level, go to some place with an established reputation, who employs people with credentials. And then meet those people eye to eye and ask them what their experiences are. Okay? Don't go out and buy a used car without driving it, in other words. The whole sports enhancement thing sounds too much like quick fix. It's hard work like anything else. It takes perseverance and maturity to find the fruition due to the training. Meet up with some experts like Phil Pheifer of Athletico and Eric Stone of Velocity Sports Performance and Tom Pukstys, people who have been around the block, so to speak. Thanks, Phil, for coming.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Much appreciated. Very interesting, Eric.
Thanks for having us
on. Much appreciated. Thanks again, Mr. Olympian. Your whole life, you're going to be referred to as an Olympian.
I worked a long time to have that ability.
How could that be any better?
It's not. I tell people that all the time.
That you represent the United States?
Even in front of wealthy baseball players, they still think the Olympics are great.
Yeah, I know that. They're looking up to you.
I cherish it every day.
Yeah,
don't think I go to sleep happy about it.
Yeah, it's great having you. Thanks for being here. And once again, my name is Terry Sullivan. This has been The Inside Corner, and I must thank you, on camera tonight, rather. I must thank Dave Izzo and Tyler Nelson and Dave Palasek, and I need to thank our new station, cable station supervisor, Mr. Bill Allen. So that's it. We'll see you again sometime soon. Dolly, don't lock the door. I'll be right home, okay? Good night, everyone.